Harper Audio presents Story, written and read by Robert McKee. Story is about principles, not rules. A rule says you must do it this way. A principle says this works and has through all remembered time. Your work needn't be modeled after the well-made play. Rather, it must be well-made within the principles that shape our art. Anxious, inexperienced writers obey rules. Rebellious, unschooled writers break rules. An artist masters the form. Story is about thoroughness, not shortcuts. From inspiration to last draft, you may need as much time to write a screenplay as to write a novel. Screen and prose writers create with the same density of world, character, and story. But because screenplay pages have so much white on them, we're often misled into thinking that a screenplay is quicker and easier than a novel. Pascal once wrote a long, drawn-out letter to a friend, then apologized in the postscript that he was sorry he didn't have time to write a short letter. Film writers cut and cut again, ruthless in their desire to express the absolute maximum in the fewest possible words. Like Pascal, screenwriters learn that economy is key, that brevity takes time, that excellence means perseverance. Story is about respect, not disdain, for the audience. When talented people write badly, it's generally for one of two reasons. Either they're blinded by an idea they feel compelled to prove to the world, or they're driven by an emotion they must express. When talented people write well, it's generally for this reason. They're moved by a desire to touch the audience. Story is about originality, not duplication. Films written by masters such as Horton Foote, Billy Wilder, Robert Altman, François Truffaut, John Cassavetes, Preston Sturges, and Ingmar Bergman are so idiosyncratic that a 5-minute synopsis identifies the artist as surely as his DNA. Great screenwriters are distinguished by a personal storytelling style, a style that's not only inseparable from their vision, but in a profound way is their vision. Their formal choices, number of protagonists, rhythm of progressions, levels of conflict, temporal arrangements, and the like, play with and against substantive choices of content, setting, character, and idea until all elements meld into a unique screenplay. If, however, we were to put the content of their films aside and study the pure patterning of their events, we'd see that, like a melody without a lyric, like a silhouette without a matrix, their story designs are powerfully charged with meaning. Your selection and arrangement of events is your master metaphor for the interconnectedness of all the levels of reality, personal, political, environmental, spiritual. Stripped of its surface of characterization and location, story structure reveals your personal cosmology, your insight into the deepest patterns and motivations for how and why things happen in this world, your map of life's hidden order. No matter who your heroes may be, Woody Allen, David Mamet, Quentin Tarantino, Ruth Prower Jabala, Oliver Stone, Zhuang Zhimou, Nora Ephron, Spike Lee, you admire them because they're unique. Each has stepped out of the crowd because he or she selects a content like no one else, designs a form like no one else, combining the two into a style unmistakably their own. I want the same for you. Imagine, in one global day, the pages of prose turned, plays performed, films screened, the unending stream of television, comedy, and drama, 24-hour print and broadcast news, bedtime tales told to children, barroom bragging, internet backfence gossip, mankind's insatiable appetite for stories. We tell and take in stories as much as we sleep, and even then we dream. Why is so much of our life spent inside stories? Because stories are equipment for living. Our appetite for story is a reflection of the profound human need to grasp the patterns of life, not merely as an intellectual exercise, but within a very personal, emotional experience. In the words of playwright Jean Ennui, fiction gives life its form. Yet, while the ever-expanding reach of the media now gives us the opportunity to send stories beyond borders and languages to hundreds of millions, the overall quality of storytelling is eroding. Each year, Hollywood produces and/or distributes 400 to 500 films, virtually a film a day. Few are excellent, but the majority are mediocre or worse. Hollywood cannot find better material than it produces. The hard-to-believe truth is that what we see on the screen each year is a reasonable reflection of the best writing of the last couple years. Why? For many reasons, but this above all, today's would-be writers rush to the typewriter without first learning their craft. If your dream were to compose music, would you say to yourself, "I've heard a lot of symphonies, I can also play the piano, I think I'll knock one out this weekend"? Of course not. You'd head for music school to study both theory and practice, focusing on the genre of symphony. After years of diligence, you'd merge your knowledge with your creativity, flex your courage, and venture to the keyboard. But that's exactly how many novice writers begin. I've seen a lot of flicks, good and bad. I got A's in English. Vacation time's coming. So they plunge in, counting solely on experience, thinking that the life they've lived and the films they've seen give them something to say and a way to say it. What they mistake for technique is simply the unconscious absorption of story elements from every novel, film, or play they've ever encountered. But unconsciously ingrained perceptions are not, in any sense, technique, and lead to screenplays clogged with clichés of the commercial or art house variety. In short, they lack a writer's education. Early in the first half of this century, teachers of creative writing, such as William Archer, Kenneth Rowe, and John Howard Lawson, taught an intrinsic understanding of story, drawing strength from the big muscle movements of desire, forces of antagonism, turning points, spine, progression, crisis, climax. Stories seen from the inside out. Over the last 25 years, however, the method of teaching creative writing in American universities has reversed from the intrinsic to the extrinsic. Trends in literary theory have drawn professors away from the deep sources of story toward language, codes, social context, stories seen from the outside. As a result, the young writer leaves the university with a sophisticated knowledge of his professional role in society, but an unfortunate ignorance of the craft needed to carry it out. While the lack of craft is critical, today we suffer from yet another cause for the decline of story. As we'll learn later, values, the positive-negative charges of life, are at the soul of our art. The writer shapes story around a perception of what's worth living for, what's worth dying for, what's foolish to pursue, what's love, justice, truth, the essential values. In decades past, it wasn't difficult to express one's beliefs because the writer and society more or less agreed on these questions. But more and more, ours has become an age of moral and ethical cynicism, relativism, and subjectivism, a great confusion of values. As the family disintegrates and sexual antagonisms rise, who, for example, feels he understands the nature of love? And how, if you have a conviction, do you express it? For this erosion of values has brought with it a corresponding erosion of story. Unlike writers in the past, we can assume nothing. First, we must dig deeply into life to uncover new insights, new refinements of value and meaning. Then create a story vehicle that expresses our interpretation to an ever more skeptical world. Therefore, my goal is simple: a good story, well told. Good story means something to say the world wants to hear. You must bring to the work a vision that's driven by fresh insights into human nature and society, coupled with an in-depth knowledge of your characters and your world. You must bring the passion for perfection and the discipline to pursue it. and talent, the innate power to put things together in a way no one else has ever dreamed. But good story, terrific characters in a world driven by your passion, courage, and creative gifts is not enough. Your goal must be a good story well told. Just as a composer must excel in the principles of musical composition, so you must master the corresponding principles of story composition. This craft is neither mechanics nor gimmicks. It is a concert of techniques by which we create a conspiracy of interest between ourselves and the audience. An artist is never at the mercy of the whims of impulse. He willingly exercises his craft to create harmonies of instinct and idea. Creativity is neither blind spontaneity nor a checklist from a how-to manual. It is the playful dance of the subconscious and conscious. Over the years, I've observed two typical and persistent kinds of failed screenplay. The first I call the personal story, bad script. In an office setting, we meet a protagonist with a problem. She deserves a promotion, but she's being passed over. Angry, she heads for her parents' home to discover that dad's gone senile and mom can't cope. Home to her apartment and a fight with her slobbish, conniving roommate. Now out on a date and smack into a failure to communicate. Her insensitive lover takes her to an expensive French restaurant, completely forgetting that she's on a diet. Next day at the office, amazingly, she gets her promotion, but with it, new pressures. Back at her parents' place, just as she solves dad's problem, mom goes over the edge. Coming home, she discovers that her roommate has stolen her TV and vanished without paying the rent. She breaks up with her lover, raids the refrigerator, and gains 5 pounds. But, chin up, she turns her promotion into a triumph. A nostalgic heart-to-heart over dinner with her folks cures mom's woes. Her new roommate not only turns out to be an anal-retentive gem who pays the rent weeks ahead with cashier's checks, but introduces her to someone new. We're now on page 95. She sticks to her diet and looks great for the last 25 pages, which are the literary equivalent of running in slow-mo through daisies, as the romance with someone new blossoms. At last she confronts her crisis decision, whether or not to commit. The film ends on a tearful climax as she decides she needs her space. Second is the guaranteed commercial success bad script. Through a luggage mix-up at the airport, a software salesman comes into possession of the thing that will end civilization as we know it today. The thing that will end civilization as we know it today is quite small. In fact, it's concealed inside a ballpoint pen, unwittingly in the pocket of this hapless protagonist, who becomes the target of a cast of 36 characters, all of whom have double or triple identities, all of whom have worked both sides of the Iron Curtain, all of whom have known one another since the Cold War, all of whom are trying to kill the guy. This script is stuffed with car chases, shootouts, hair-raising escapes, and explosions. When not blowing things up or shooting folks down, it halts for dialogue-thick scenes as the hero tries to sort through these duplicitous people and find out just whom can he trust. It ends on a cacophony of violence and multi-million-dollar effects, during which the hero manages to destroy the thing that would end civilization as we know it today and thus save humanity. The personal story is an understructured slice-of-life portraiture that mistakes verisimilitude for the truth. This writer believes that the more precise his observation of day-to-day facts, the more accurate his reportage of what actually happens, the more truth he tells. But fact, no matter how minutely observed, is truth with a small t. Capital T truth is located behind, beyond, inside, below the surface of things, holding reality together or tearing it apart, and cannot be directly observed. Because this writer sees only what is visible and factual, he is blind to the truth of life. The guaranteed commercial success, on the other hand, is an overstructured, overly complicated, overly populated assault on the physical senses that bears no relationship to life whatsoever. This writer is mistaken.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.